Hello, my name is Dr. Billy Wu and I'm a senior lecturer in the Dyson School of Design Engineering at Imperial College London, and today I'll be talking to you about our paper in Applied Energy on the effects of cell-to-cell variations and thermal gradients on the performance and degradation of lithium-ion battery packs, which covers some of the challenges around the scale-up of battery electric vehicles. First of all, it's important to understand the importance of decarbonising transport. Here you can see data relating to the average emissions of EU vehicle fleets. Back in 2010, vehicles were emitting approximately 160 grams of CO2 per kilometre, and where we want to be in 2050 is under 20 grams of CO2 per kilometre to avoid irreversible climate change. Now, through a combination of vehicle lightweighting and optimisation of the internal combustion engine, we can probably get this down to about 80 grams of CO2 per kilometre. And if we hybridize this with a battery to reduce transient loads and improve efficiency, we can hit about 60 grams of CO2 per kilometer, but it's still far short of the 20 grams of CO2 per kilometer we need to reach. Therefore, we need to develop zero emission electric vehicle technology now. You can see that passenger vehicles contribute to over 50% of these emissions, and this is one of the reasons why we're putting a strong push for electrification of consumer transport. However, with any new technology, there's a number of challenges that need to be overcome. Here, you can see two example battery packs. In the first example, a Tesla Model S, which uses cylindrical cells from Panasonic, has a 75 kilowatt hour battery pack, which gives approximately 500 kilometers worth of range and consists of around 4,000 cells built into a 96S 46P battery pack. That's 96 cells in series and 46 cells in parallel. In the other example, the Chevrolet Bolt uses pouch cells from LG Chem and has a 60 kilowatt hour battery pack, which provides approximately 380 kilometers worth of range. This is made up of 288 cells connected in a 96S 3P configuration. As we move forward, there will be a number of different battery pack designs, but it's common to see cells connected in parallel to increase their capacity. However, this can cause problems. The plot you see here highlights this. Initially, the performance of an individual cell and a battery pack are the same. However, after 1,200 cycles, the single cell has lost 28% of its original capacity, but the battery pack, after 750 cycles, has already reduced to 35%. So, the question is, what is the source of this additional degradation? This next plot then shows the initial performance of Panasonic 18650 cells is reasonably consistent. However, after a few hundred cycles, slight differences in the cells start to get amplified and the remaining capacity starts to deviate significantly. Thus, single cell performance doesn't necessarily translate to pack performance, and we need to understand what drives this accelerated loss of performance. To help us figure out the root cause of this issue, models can be used, but let's first look at how a lithium-ion battery works. If you look inside of a cylindrical cell, you'll see a structure which is similar to a Swiss roll with layers of copper, graphite, which acts as the anode, an electrically insulating separator, a metal oxide cathode, and aluminium. The anode, separator, and cathode are porous, with these pores filled with an ionically conductive electrolyte. In the fully charged state, lithium is inserted or intercalated into the graphite. When the battery is discharged, the lithium becomes a lithium ion and an electron. The lithium ion diffuses to the cathode, but the electron has to go around an external circuit where useful electrical work can be done. At the cathode, the lithium ion is recombined with the electron and intercalated into the metal oxide. When the battery is charged, the opposite reaction occurs. Now, in order to describe what's happening in the battery, one of the most well-established models is the Newman pseudo 2D model, which is named after John Newman in honor of his work in the area. This model solves a number of partial differential equations which describe the diffusion and voltage drops in the solid and electrolyte phases. These equations are then coupled with the Butler-Volmer equation, which describes the rate of electrochemical reactions in the electrode with factors such as the rate of diffusion and charge transfer thermally coupled. This model can also be modified to account for one of the main degradation modes in lithium batteries, which is related to growth of the solid electrolyte interface. This is a passivation layer on the anode which consumes cyclable lithium, reducing capacity and also increasing the resistance, which results in power fade. However, this is just one of many different degradation modes in lithium-ion batteries. Now, whilst this model is good at predicting the performance of the battery, it can be quite computationally expensive when you start simulating multiple cells, as is the case for a battery pack. Thus, one of the most commonly used simplifications is the single particle model, where each electrode is reduced to a single particle, as the name suggests, and no concentration gradient is generated in the electrolyte. This model runs much faster, which is ideal for pack simulations, however starts to lose accuracy at higher currents. Now, if we then take this single particle model and put it into a parallel string of cells, which is commonly done to increase the capacity, you might intuitively think that the current is split evenly across all cells. However, what you see is that because of the finite interconnection resistance in the pack, this can cause some cells to provide more current than others. These interconnection resistances are inevitable and come from pieces of metal that link up the cells as well as the contact resistances. In this example, the current in cell 1, which is closest to the load point, provides approximately twice as much current as cell 6, which is furthest from the load point, because the cell experiences a larger resistance. This later reverses when the state of charge of cell 1 drops and the internal resistance increases, pushing more load to cell 6, which is a trend seen in both the modeled and experimental results. Then, as we increase the current from 0.25 C to 1 C, which equates to a discharge time of 4 hours versus 1 hour, the magnitude of the current heterogeneity increases, which can cause problems for localized heating and uneven degradation. If we then have a look at the voltage profiles of these two cases at relatively low discharge rates, there isn't too much of a difference between the single cell performance and the pack performance. However, as the current is increased, the additional losses of the interconnection resistances and uneven currents becomes more evident, which results in a loss of power in the battery pack. Now, in that example, all the cells were exactly the same. However, there will inevitably be some sort of cell-to-cell variation. This is highlighted in the paper by Rumpf et al., which shows the variation in capacity and resistance for 1,100 commercial lithium-ion batteries. And depending on the age and manufacturing quality of the cells, this can be significantly larger. So, what impact will these variations have on the performance of the lithium-ion battery pack? To investigate this, an additional resistance was added to each cell, with the additional resistance moved from cell 1 to 6 sequentially. Now, in the base case where all the cells are the same, the uneven current split can clearly be seen with the dotted line representing what the ideal case would be. Cell 1 provides most of the current and cell 6 provides the least. If we then add a cell with a higher internal resistance to cell location 6, this exacerbates the problem, with cell 6 delivering even less current initially, though this later increases as the depth of discharge increases. However, if we place a cell at location 1, which was initially providing the most current, this can actually help to homogenize the current distribution and improve the performance as it shifts the current back towards the other cells. Therefore, the conclusion here is that intelligent cell placement can improve the battery pack performance through more homogenized current distribution. When we look at how much this impacts the performance compared to the extrapolated single cell performance behavior where we ignore interconnection resistances and have the same cell, there are some clear differences. In the case of including the interconnection resistances at a discharge rate of 1.5 C, there's an approximate drop of about 10% in the output energy with this increasing with the current. Now, depending on the location of the cell with the highest resistance, it can be seen that this can make approximately 10% further difference in the accessible energy. Here, the uneven current is a key factor in this, with cell location 1 being the best place to locate the cell as it helps to equalize the current distribution. Of course, cell-to-cell inconsistencies are not the only source of resistance variations. Since batteries are electrochemical devices, their performance is highly temperature dependent, and thermal gradients can impact the performance of these battery packs significantly. So let's have a look at a case where we have a 25 degree thermal gradient with cell 1 being at 20 degrees and cell 6 being at 45 degrees. Because cell 1 delivers a higher average current is able to access more of its energy over a cycle. Making cell 6 a higher temperature decreases its resistance, which does help to reduce the uneven currents. However, the impact is that this cell then degrades faster than cell 1. If we then reverse the thermal gradient, we can see that the output energy of cell 1 increases, as this is the cell already with the highest current load, and we've just reduced its resistance further, increasing the load through that cell. While cell 6 is now colder, which further reduces the accessible energy from the cell. However, the degradation of cell 1 is now over twice that of cell 6. If we then compare the accessible energy of the pack with no thermal gradients at 45, 32.5 and 20 degrees C, it can clearly be seen that at higher temperatures, the accessible energy is the highest due to faster kinetics of the electrochemical reactions and the faster diffusion. However, this also accelerates the degradation of the cells. If we have a 20 degree to 45 degree thermal gradient, this helps to equalize the uneven currents in the pack and increases the energy output. However, having a hotter cell in the pack compared to the pack with all cells at 32.5 degrees C results in additional degradation. In the case where there's a 45 to 20 degree thermal gradient, this exacerbates the uneven current problem, resulting in significantly lower accessible energy. However, this lowers the rate of degradation slightly, since the cells spend less time at high states of charge. This therefore highlights the need to consider the impact of thermal gradients in lithium-ion battery packs, though it should be noted that only SEI layer growth was considered in this model, and other degradation modes do exist in batteries. So, to summarize, electrification of transport is essential to avoid irreversible climate change. Single cell performance doesn't translate to pack performance. Interconnection resistances in highly parallel battery packs impacts the current distribution. Cell-to-cell variability is inevitable. Placement of cells can have a significant impact on the overall performance of the battery pack. Placing more resistive cells in locations of high load can help to rebalance the current distribution. And thermal gradients can exacerbate or minimize the current variations, and therefore informed thermal management design is needed. I'd also like to thank the funding agencies for supporting this work. This includes the EPSRC Energy Storage for Low Carbon Grids project, Joint UK-India Clean Energy Centre, the Faraday Institution Multiscale Modelling Project, and the Innovate UK Advanced Battery Lifetime Extension Project. And we'd also like to thank the constructive comments from Dr. Chris Dent and Dr. Fan Lin Meng from Durham University. So thank you for listening, and if you'd like to check out our paper or download the slides, these are linked below.